Hi, my name is Sarah Medland, and I'll be talking to you today about heterogeneity. So the terminology that we use when talking about heterogeneity in genetic analyses depends a bit on the type of research question that we're trying to ask. We could be asking questions about moderation, about confounding, or about the interaction between genetic and environmental parameters. In our models, we can estimate the effects of measured or manifest moderators or confounders, or unmeasured or latent moderators or confounders. Our measured confounders or moderators can be binary, ordinal, or continuous. And we can think about both moderation and interaction in the unmeasured or latent space. So when we're running a univariate analysis, our key question are usually around what's the relative importance of genetic and environmental factors and how do they contribute to the variance? Whereas in heterogeneity, what we're asking are the contributions of genetic and environmental factors actually equal between groups, or do they change with a moderating factor? Common moderators that we use, or common groupings that we investigate in this type of analysis, are based around sex, race, ethnicity, social economic status, and environmental exposures. The one I'll be talking about most today is about sex differences. And in this type of analysis, we do use the terminology sex differences rather than gender differences, but incorporating gender, if we have a good measure of gender, would be an entirely valid update to these analyses. So we tend to look at differences in the magnitude of effects, and we call these quantitative differences. So they differ in the quantity, whereas we also look at differences in the source or the nature of the effects, and we call these qualitative differences. So differences in the influencing factors. And in particular with sex differences, we have some fairly unusual terminology, and these are referred to in the literature as sex limitation effects. So this terminology is quite old, and we can see the earliest mentions of it in the 1800s if you go back into the literature. And this terminology has been carried forward, and as you'll see, it sort of becomes quite compound in its nature. So thinking about sex differences and thinking about quantitative and qualitative differences, there are actually multiple models that map onto both quantitative or qualitative differences. So if someone tells you they're interested in measuring quantitative differences, we actually don't know which model they've run. So because of this, there is a set of models that are most commonly run, and they have some additional terminology within the literature. So our first model that we're going to talk about is called a scalar model, or a scalar limitation model. This model is usually thought of as measuring quantitative differences. And the idea here is that the difference is in the total variance. So the proportion of genetic and environmental factors is actually equal between your groups. So in this case, the heritability or the ACE proportions would be equal between groups, but the total variance is bigger in one of the groups. And we can set this up conceptually in our sort of little equations there by showing that each of the variances is equal, but with a multiplier, which we usually use the letter K for in our equations. So in this case, if we wanted to say that the male variance is twice that of the female variance, the K in this case would be 2. How does this look in a model? So here is our standard no heterogeneity twin model. So this is an ACE model. It maps onto our variance covariance matrix that we're used to seeing. And then if we want to incorporate our scalar effect, we can simply do that by including our scalar on the variance of one of the sexes. Okay, the second model that we're used to seeing in the literature is called a non-scalar limitation model. As you can imagine, there technically are many different models that are non-scalar, but this one is referred to specifically as the non-scalar sex limitation model. So this model can be run without data from opposite sex twin pairs, which makes it very useful if you haven't been able to collect that data. And it's typically thought of as measuring quantitative differences in between the sexes. So here the premise is that the total variance is not equal between males and females, but that the proportions also differ. So the proportions of A, C, and E, or at least one of these proportions, does differ between males and females. So when we run this model, we typically set up a different mean for males and females, and then we estimate the parameters of A, C, and E separately for males and females, or A, D, and E if we're running an ADE model. How does that look? We literally have basically two sets of models, so one for the males and one for the females. These are estimated jointly in the model at the same time, but because we have no opposite sex pairs, they're actually effectively estimated separately. So our next type of non-scalar model is a common effects sex limitation model. So this is a model where we do have data from our opposite sex twin pairs, and we think of this as a quantitative sex limitation model. So in this model, we estimate our male parameters and our female parameters, and then these parameters are estimated jointly or linked by the opposite sex correlations. So the correlations here are set to be the expectations. So they're similar to the previous regular twin models that we run without heterogeneity. So we use a correlation of 0.5 for our additive genetic factors between our male and female opposite sex twins, a correlation of 1 for our common effect, common environmental effects, and our uncorrelated environmental effects are set to correlate 0. So how does that look in the model? You can see here on the diagram, we use the male estimates for our male twins, the female estimates for our female twins, and then the cross paths are based on those relationships between the male and female factors. So this one is a non-scalar sex limitation model, and it's also called a common effects sex limitation model to specifically indicate that it has the opposite sex twins in there, and the effects are said to be common. So there's no heterogeneity in terms of qualitative heterogeneity in this model. So the last type of model that we'll be talking about is called a general non-scalar limitation model. And in this model, once again, we have our opposite sex twin pairs, but this time we're trying to estimate both quantitative and qualitative sex limitation. There's two different ways that we can go about this, so I'll walk you through them both. The first way is to estimate a specific effect for either males or females. And so the way that we do this is we have our male parameters, our female parameters, and then an extra parameter. And this specific effect can be used to estimate specific genetic or specific common environmental effects, and it can be assigned to either gender. So here I've assigned it to the females. And once again, our estimates are linked by our opposite sex correlations as they were in the previous model. So how does this look in practice? So we have a model that looks quite similar to last time. We have our male parameters, our female parameters. We have our cross paths to indicate our correlations between our opposite sex twins. And we now have this one specific. So the specific is correlated between female pairs, but not between opposite sex pairs. We refer to this one as a general non-scalar sex limitation model. So what this allows us to do is have an extra set of genetic factors that only apply to one sex, or an extra set of environmental factors that only apply to one sex. What this in fact does is it means it allows our genetic or our environmental factors to be correlated not at one between males and females. So the alternate way to set up this model, which some people might find easier to think about, is to actually directly estimate the genetic or the environmental relationship between our males and females. So this model, once again, requires our opposite sex twin pairs. We have our female parameters, our male parameters. And now the difference is that we're estimating a correlation between our male and female parameters. So once again, we can either do this for our additive genetic effects, our dominance effects, or our common environmental effects. It is more usually seen in the literature, though, within our additive genetic effects. How does this look in our model? We have, once again, our male parameters, our female parameters, our cross paths, and you can see here we're directly estimating a correlation. So this is called a general sex limitation model, again. So why would we use this other parameterization where we have a specific? So this can be easier to code and it can be easier to optimize. And if you're going to large arbitrary pedigrees where you have potentially many siblings or other relationships, it can be easier to set it up this way with the specific rather than a correlation. The two models should give equivalent fit and they are really asking the same question. It's just modeling it in two different ways. So when we have this model, if we want to test for qualitative differences, what we would do is to drop our specific effect, or if we're using the alternate parameterization, we would fix this correlation. And once we've done that, it drops back to a quantitative model. So it takes away that qualitative component and drops it back to a quantitative model. After that, you would go ahead and potentially look to see whether you can equate your estimates of A, C, and E between the males and the females. Okay, so that's all I have to say about heterogeneity and sex limitation, but please feel free to email or reach out if you have questions. Thank you.